while introducing. But then he tarrieth not 1 hour in the truth, unless he be constrained by divine power. And his seal is this, which is to be worn as aforesaid, etc. In my interpretation, the Gurusha offers a method of dealing with these supposed demons who are liars by giving them gifts, which after he is supposed to act within 1 hour according to the will of God. I feel as if this method is more of a safeguard for the magician than a method of working with a demon. In my experiences, I began to see results within a few days. Situations that had been difficult to influence with magic broke through for me, allowing me to get what I wanted. During that evocation, I became the focus of my boss's interest at work because I began to offer him tarot readings, which he came to depend on while I worked at that job. I found it interesting that he would put so much trust in my readings, basing his business decisions on his readings and his family relationship on what I read for him. But at the same time, I knew that Bilal's influence allowed for the situation to occur, a situation much more dynamic than what just one spell could produce. The last line is about the seal of Bilal, and it states that the seal should be worn, etc. I think that the reason for this is so that the sigil can be created from a specific metal and carried as a talisman for protection and control of the demon at all times. What I found to be useful was to create a ritual on a specific day and create the sigil for the demon on a piece of parchment paper, which would be saved as long as I desired to keep working with that demon. The act of creating the sigil is symbolic. It represents manifesting the spirit into our world, just as you created that sigil upon the paper. It's best to keep the sigil in a safe and private place. For the Bilal ritual, you should reference the Shemham Mefarash table. It is a table that shows the 72 demons and their associations. In this table, the 72 demons of the Gurusha are attributed in pairs, one for the day and one for the night, and they also represent 36 beacons of the zodiac in periods of 10 degrees. The Shemha Mefarash shows that Bilal is a night spirit ruled by Aquarius, the element of air, and the tarot suit of swords. You can gain a lot of knowledge on how to set up an appropriate ritual just from this information alone. If Bilal is a night spirit, then night is the best time to do the ritual. I would suggest also that the night the ritual is done, you should plan to do it when the moon is in Aquarius. If you do not know what house the moon is in, you can check an ephemeris and plan to do the ritual that night. Aquarius is ruled by Uranus, so you can use this to find the appropriate colors and incense for the ritual. The book 777, written by Aleister Crowley, relates Uranus to the magical will. According to 777, Aquarius vibrates to the color violet. The stone for Aquarius is chalcedony and the quartz, and the stone represented by the element of air is the yellow topaz. Aquarius is represented by the number 9, the herb of mandrake, demania, the banyan, the flower jasmine, ginseng, and galbanum resin. It is also related to Saturn, as Saturn ruled Aquarius along with Uranus, and from this you could add incense such as cedar, pine, or patchouli, which are associated with Saturn. Aquarius also represents independence. Its exaltation is humanity, and its detriment is the sun, its planetary opposite on the astrology wheel, and that represents self-absorption, selfishness, and self-righteousness. Where Crowley says that galbanum is too demonic to be represented by Aquarius because it represents the darker aspects of the planetary energies, I feel that that would be a perfect association for this spirit at night. On the right-hand side, you can read my list of references that I've used. And below that, you will also find a mini bibliography on different versions of the Gurusha that you can find at Amazon and different places on the net. And thank you for watching my video.